A close-up look at animal welfare issues is supported by AnimalWelfareIssues.com.
You are watching A Close-Up Look at Animal Welfare Issues with your host, writer, speaker, and advocate, Tina Evangelista Eppenstein. This show is supported in part by AnimalWelfareIssues.com, spotlighting issues around the globe. Check out the latest TV shows, articles, podcasts, and more. That's AnimalWelfareIssues.com. Now here's your host, Tina, in 3, 2, 1.
Hey everybody, this is Tina. You're looking at Bernhard's Dam, what's left of it. It's done. Bernhard's Dam Lake is no more. It's there's a small pond there that's remaining, but it's just really a sad sight. There's some wildlife there yet, but it has officially been drained. Dam has been removed. And we're going to talk about that on today's show. And welcome, everybody. Yeah, that was Bernhard's Dam. We have Memorial Day coming up, which is why I'm wearing red, white, and blue. And it's also Military Appreciation Month. I want to get to some butterflies that I'm raising. And ticks are going to be bad this year. But I want to say hi to Quiz Kid. How you doing, Quiz Kid?
I'm here, doing good. Summer's coming.
I know. I mean, it's like, we always say Happy Memorial Day, and we're honoring, you know, the men and women and animals who have fought for this country and died during their service. So, I mean, it is the unofficial beginning to right. Summertime.
Seems like we were just complaining about the cold, and now all of a sudden,
I know.
Past weekend we had in the 90s.
It's going back and forth. I mean, we just had 90s over the weekend, and now, I mean, it's really nice out, but it's kind of strange weather. But we are coming up on Memorial Day, and we're going to talk about that. But first, I do want to talk about Bernhard's Dam. And I was out there the other day. I was out there prior as well, but you know, Pennsylvania EPA said, you know, this is going to have to be drained. It poses some kind of threat, and they have drained it. And I'm waiting for the inspection report, the assessment to see what's happening. And you know, I caught some other video of it, and I saw dead fish.
Yeah.
I guess there were bass, I'm guessing. I think they stocked it with bass, but there was a lot of fish that were dead. There are still some geese there with their babies, if we can show that. And yeah, no, this isn't my photograph. This is a Tim Russo. He was out there. There are ducklings out there. In that video I showed at the beginning, at the top, I took that, and there were geese there. And, you know, I was a distance from them, but they started walking away. And, but they came back. They didn't walk very far. They just weren't sure. I mean, this is all new to them, and it's just so sad that they...
This is, I don't know. I grew up and I fished Bernhard's for years. I mean,
it's a big time recreational area. A lot of people have gone there. A lot of people are upset over
right.
this.
Yeah, I mean, you look out, and that lake gets really visited by a lot of different ducks before they head up north, like buffleheads, mcgansers,
swans.
Yes,
yeah,
swans.
They have swans there. They had pairs of swans there. I saw one pair of swans there. Like I said, they have just a little bit of pond area. And
with that small pond, though, they're susceptible to predation right now because there's coyotes in that area now. They've been spotted.
Yeah.
It is going to be a dangerous thing right now because...
Well, they're not going to... And they haven't relocated any of the wildlife. They said it would hurt the ecosystem and...
There is no ecosystem when you drain a lake.
What's that?
When you drain a lake like that, your ecosystem's gone. The water is the ecosystem.
I know. Now,
I know, it's a shame.
So I don't understand why or how it's going to hurt the ecosystem, but, you know, it's just sad, taking the home away from wildlife, you know. They have to be wondering, these geese, you know.
Yeah.
The geese, we know about the geese there, you know, they go all over the grass, but it's so sad, and I don't know what they have found that's wrong.
There is a lot of lead in the bottom.
Well, they said they cleaned it up. And by 2011, they closed it in 1996. And because of the lead issue from the former Exide, right. In 2011 they reopened it and they said everything was fine.
But not the lake bed. They stripped down the ground around the lake bed. They took down a foot, took it out, burned it, and brought it back. That lake bed is loaded with lead, so they're going to have to dig and excavate that ground at least a foot down.
If they haven't decided what they're going to do, because they're going to wait for this
assessment.
Well,
wouldn't you think about that ahead of time? What you're going to do before you drain something?
They can just remove everything and it costs like over $300,000, or they can put
it back.
The lake back and it's going to cost millions, or they could do the whole thing and that's still going to cost millions and it'll come back on the taxpayers. I don't know what way they're going to go. Same as Angelica Park. Yeah. That was once, a
nice... Now we have Carsonia left. If you think about it, you're running out of lakes to go.
I know.
I mean,
and recreational areas.
Antietam and Carsonia, the two that are left in this area.
And it's just really a shame. And I feel bad, for the wildlife
and the people that live there too.
I did see some people that there's some baby turtles that are walking around into the neighborhood, and people are saying that they moved into that area across the street. There are homes, and they moved there because of Bernhardt's Dam, and now it's a sore sight to look at. When you drive by it, it's just all dried up. But I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen.
And the city owns it. It isn't Muhlenberg. It's actually the city.
It belongs to the city. Actually, that lake was there since 1796.
Right.
And I think it's John Bernhardt who bought it.
Yeah.
And he had it and had a grist mill there. And then the city, got involved. They needed it for the water, and that's how it all got involved, and it improved, and now it's just gone.
Yeah.
It's just really, really sad.
I mean, they can redo the dam and actually make it stronger. That was their big beef, that it wouldn't hold back a huge amount of rain, which the amount of rain they said was something astronomical that would never happen.
I know.
And if it did happen, the least thing you're going to worry about is a lake dam going, because everything else would have been underwater.
So it's
story of Bernhardt's.
It's a sad ending. I mean, I don't know if it's going to go the way of Angelica Park. I think they said there's still a little creek running through it, but
yeah.
I mean, I saw tires there, bottles, a boot, fishing rod. But I know a man and his son were there trying to save the fish.
Yeah,
but there's a lot of dead fish. But they were saving the fish and turtles, so that was nice. I'd like to switch gears now. Let's talk about Military Appreciation Day. Military Appreciation Month, not day, a month. It goes with Memorial Day, but this is appreciate the military all year long, and I do. I've told some people how much I appreciate them, and that's why I'm patriotic. I wear my red, white, and blue, but we don't want to forget about our military. They do a great job. Memorial Day, we honor those who have, died. I mean, these people, men, women, and animals, have fought for our country and died for our country, and they need to be honored. They're my heroes, and I just have a quick video to show about Military Appreciation Month.
Call to serve. It has no sound, yet I have heard it in the whispered retelling of honorable sacrifices made by those who have served before me. The call to serve has no form, yet I have clearly seen it in the eyes of men and women infinitely more courageous and more driven than most. The call to serve has no weight, yet I have held it in my hands. I will commit to carry it close to my heart until my country is safe and the anguish of those less fortunate has been soothed. The call to serve is at once invisible and always present. And for those who choose to answer the call, for their country, for their fellow man, for themselves, it is the most powerful force on earth.
So, you know, tell somebody who's in the military or has been in the military how much you appreciate them. And Memorial Day, we have parades, and fewer people are going. But I ask, you know, while you're celebrating in the beginning of summer, and it is a fun time, I mean, let's not forget the reason for this holiday.
The reason we're having fun is because we're safe for now, knock on wood.
Yeah.
I mean, if we screw this up, we really, we're screwed. So, I mean, they sacrificed all. You imagine you're sending 18, 19-year-old kids to fight a war, and they've never even got to live their life, and now their life's taken away from them.
I know.
You know, it's never more. But yet, the reason we're here today is because of them. And I don't think people, I think people got to wake up.
Yeah, I don't think people realize how much we owe to them. And I know there's some people who don't honor them. I most certainly do. I was just at the Armed Forces Day Parade, and a fewer people are going to that, you know. But, you know, either I support them. I truly do. But also have safe fun for Memorial Day. And also, if you have dogs, cats, please keep them in a safe place for, you know, because of fireworks. You know, people are setting them off now, you know, around their homes, which they shouldn't, and this is really scaring
the stadiums,
a lot of pets. Now, July 4th is the biggest intake. Well, I don't know anymore. The Animal Rescue League is no longer open admission, so other rescues have to step up to the plate, and there's Burke's Dog Search, Burke's Cat Search on Facebook, and they help to reunite pets. So I don't want to get into that, but I mean, yeah, that's true. Neither of the big shelters in here in Berks County just taking any animal any longer, and I just found that out, and that's really sad, you know. I mean, ARL was always open admission, and well, that's a different story. I don't want to get into that.
Day.
But let's honor those who have served this country and have fun, but watch out for your pets in that. And I'm going to switch gears again. I want to switch it over to butterflies. This is not quite butterfly season, but I had black swallowtails who overwintered at my house.
What do you mean by overwintered?
The butterflies, you know, turn into a caterpillar, and
right.
The caterpillar turns into a chrysalis, and then like in 10 to 14 days, the butterfly comes out. However, this is last fall, and if it's too cool for them, they just stay in that chrysalis.
Oh.
You know, and they, black swallowtails aren't the same as monarchs. They come out whenever they want to, and they were outside.
Is it a type of hibernation? Like they don't freeze?
It's a type of hibernation. It's called diapause.
Oh, okay.
You know, they're pausing their life for a little bit, and
so who determines when they come out?
They do.
They do.
They do.
Along with the temperatures, obviously.
What's that?
Along with the temperatures, obviously.
Yeah. I mean, if you keep them in the house, they'll come out, you know, over the wintertime.
On that, you don't
want. The holidays, so. But mine, I had like 84 chrysalids.
Wow.
Because last year, most of them did not come out. And, 84 and I think close to 80 that I've released so far. I actually have one chrysalis left.
No, you so. Do. So yeah. You had that good of a ratio of that they made it over the winter.
Yeah, they're great. And if we can show them, I have video and pictures. If we can just show that.
Wow.
Yeah, that's just three. I think in one day, I don't know, or 2 days, 16 or 18. But they remind me of hummingbirds. Their wings go so fast. They're so anxious to get out, and I release them in my yard. And I just love them. They are gorgeous. They're black.
How do you tell a male from a female?
Well, I have a picture coming up,
okay.
And after the video. But, you know, after I take the videos and pictures, I release them. And, okay, now, quiz kid.
Yeah.
Do you know which is male and which is female, or do you see any differences?
The only thing I think is brighter would be the one on the left. The bigger one might be the male.
You're right.
Oh,
the bigger one is the male. Typically, the female is larger. Now, I've had all sizes this year. This is a smaller female, and they both have black and yellow dots. The yellow dots are more prominent on a male. The blue is more prominent on a female, and it goes up more. It's a powdery blue. I mean, they're gorgeous.
That's a good shot there. I mean,
thanks. It's just, and they have gifted us with some more eggs. Found more eggs and caterpillars for swallowtails.
What do they lay their eggs on? What kind of plant?
Rue, dill, parsley, carrot, top the carrot leaves, Queen Anne's lace.
So it's mainly herbs, something with an
herbs, definitely. And I just want to tell people, if you see these, you know, caterpillars, I don't know if I sent a picture of a caterpillar or not. I did not. But if you see caterpillars on these plants that I just talked about, don't kill them. I mean, people, I know there are some people who think they're pests, but they turn into these butterflies, and they're gorgeous. But I also have like good news about monarchs. And monarchs, I actually have four caterpillars. And this is a first, to be this early in the year for monarchs here in this area in PA. They're actually in New York, New Jersey, I think Michigan, Minneapolis. So it's really, really early for
it
here.
It seems early.
I don't know why. They've pushed up, and like the butterflies, as we call them, you know, we've noticed this pattern from monarchwatch.org or Journey North.
Right.
Journey North.
Wasn't last year a really good year for the numbers down in Mexico?
Well, actually, the numbers just came out. It's funny that you asked.
Oh.
The numbers just came out, and there is a slight increase.
A slight? I thought it was supposed to be. They had
it
wrong.
I know.
Okay.
They say don't rely on the numbers because you never know.
First of all, I don't know how you count them. Any butterflies coating trees? I don't know how they estimate. I have no clue.
There are people out there who count them, like in Cape May, where my husband and I went 2 years ago. They are literally on the streets counting the number of butterflies. So.
Okay.
That's, you know, there are people out there who literally count them, and then sometimes they just take them like per block and then, you know, multiply. I'm guessing. I think so.
Okay.
But to have four, you know, when I have four caterpillars, and you know, I found the eggs, and so, I mean, I'm going to have monarch butterflies, you know, in June, and I was like, wow,
yeah.
You know, I mean, that's really, really
unusual. So now your season begins. Now you and your husband are constantly raising monarchs till October?
Yeah, it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
And okay. But I just, it's just great helping nature. But I haven't seen any monarchs. Have you seen any monarchs?
No, I've seen butterflies, but I haven't seen monarchs yet.
Yeah, obviously.
I mean, they're obviously here if you're found.
If I found eggs, I mean, they're not commonplace yet. This isn't their time, but some other of my friends have seen monarchs. And like
so these aren't the ones from Mexico. It's the second generation.
Yeah,
okay.
They died. You know, coming up north, you almost have to wonder though because they came up here so early, but. They're saying like that first generation from Mexico has died,
right.
And these are their offspring. And now
you
these
think
offspring.
The storms had anything to do pushing them up?
No one knows yet.
Okay.
No one's saying at least. So I don't know, but it's cool though. I like raising the butterflies,
yeah.
You know, because the monarch population is in serious trouble. You know, they have declined so much. So. You know, the more we can help them, the better, although some disagree with that as well. I guess you're never going to please everybody. But
it's good.
I love it.
Yeah.
And now to talk about insects, let's talk about the tick.
Okay.
Ticks are going to be bad this year, they said.
Right.
And I haven't seen any. But just want to remind everybody, you need to check your pets, check your dog, and you want to check at their ears, in their ears, under the flap, around their ears, top of their head, their legs, and the inside, their toes. Let's see, the back of the legs, at the butt. But they could be anywhere.
Right.
You know, but you want to really do a thorough check because
Lyme disease
is bad.
If you have a long-haired dog, what do you do? Is there a comb?
You have to check.
But do they have a comb that you can?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, you can buy a comb, use your own comb, but and feel your dog. I mean, you know, see if there's any bumps or lumps, and but you want to get that tick out, but you really need to be careful, and you need to pull out the entire body. Some people can rip off the body, but you know, leave part of it in.
The head.
And Lyme disease, I've had three dogs now with Lyme disease, and you know, it can cause a lot of issues, and they can die from Lyme disease.
It takes it hits their kidneys then, doesn't it? I know it's for some reason it's hard on Labradors. They're more prone to dying from Lyme disease than any other dog, I think.
Yeah.
So
it's sad, you know, what it can do.
So you have to catch it early. So what is a sign of a dog having a Lyme disease?
Well, there's different signs. Some dogs don't have any symptoms, just like a person.
But I mean, don't they have like a
lameness in one leg?
An irregular gait, like they.
Well, yeah, the lameness, and then you're picking up one leg, but it goes to another leg as well. So that's a sign.
Right.
If like your dog's hurting, but it goes from one leg to another, that's a sign.
Are they lethargic?
They can be lethargic, a lack of appetite, fatigued. My dog was so fatigued from it. And another dog of mine showed no symptoms, so.
But he tested positive.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, three dogs have tested positive. My dog now, my tripod, he has tested positive.
This is a hot area. This is like one of the worst. Berks County
yeah,
is like.
There's a hotbed for ticks here for people and for animals. And the vet always tell me, you really have to be careful with the ticks. And do you check your cat? Do you let your cat out?
I don't leave him out, so I don't have to check him. See, that's one of the reasons I don't leave him out.
Do you have your, I think I asked you this before. Your cat's not declawed, right?
No.
Okay.
No.
But yeah, still a lot of cats out there, by the way.
Yeah,
in my neighborhood. How about yours?
Yeah, I wonder if that has anything to do with what you're saying about the different shelters that aren't accepting cats now either.
Yeah, could be.
I mean, that's crazy.
Yeah, rescues are stepping up, but they don't have a lot of money here. They're not getting funded, and they
seems
will
like
go
they're
under.
Throwing money at everything else nowadays. Why don't they throw some money towards? I mean.
Well, this is privately funded through
okay.
private citizens. So if you know of a group, that is good. And if you're able, give some money. How many minutes was that? Five, okay. So we have 5 minutes left. Anything you want to say?
You were talking about ticks. The Lone Star tick is new to this area. It's been in this area.
Yeah, Lone Star. It's actually from southeastern states, but it is here.
It has a very odd, peculiar disease that goes along with it.
Well, first of all, the tick has a white spot on
in
its
the back. Right.
Okay. And what disease?
I forgot the name of it.
But what are the symptoms?
The symptom is you cannot no longer eat red meat or meat products or things with meat products. Yeah. And it turns you into an instant vegetarian. And it's kind of weird. It comes on, you get deathly sick, just like a peanut allergy or an egg allergy to meat. And I don't have the name offhand, but it's a condition of it, and it's rare. It's not as rare as you think, because I'm hearing more and more people, hunters, that got it, you know, that they told me that they can't eat meat anymore. I mean, just totally.
Why?
Because of the enzyme in the meat reacts with the disease that the Lone Star tick.
Yeah,
I've
never heard of that.
Oh, it's very strange, and it's for real.
I know, you can't take these, you have to take the tick seriously, you know. And insects, spiders, whatever. I mean, you have to be careful. Some spiders can kill you, you know?
Yeah, we have the brown recluse and we have the black widow in PA. Brown recluse has been biting a lot of people, giving them neurological symptoms that are actually, you know, in line with a stroke. You get paralysis, you get the whole nine yards, and you get, it has a very bad bite. And a lot of people get bit at night because they don't realize there's a tick in their house and it ends up roll over on it and get nailed, you know.
So it's. I mean, we're now in the warmer seasons and we have to really be careful. Well, hopefully it stays warm.
Yeah.
I mean, and we're down, okay. I got to wrap it up here because I want to close the show with a video from Memorial Day, and it's a tribute to the men, women, but there are also animals in it. But I want to say this before I sign off. The tragedy that happened in Texas, and this has nothing to do with animals, but the tragedy that occurred. So far, 19 children and two teachers were murdered by an 18-year-old. And there's two missing girls yet. The latest is they haven't found them. And, you know, I hope and pray that they're okay, but it doesn't sound good. I can't fathom that, you know. And, you know, read in social media or in articles, and everybody's making this political, you know, immediately after. And we just, we just have to, now is not the time to make it political. Disappointed with the president to make it political immediately. These parents are hurting, and we need to get to the core of the issue. I mean, a lot of people, these people who go in there and murder innocent people have some serious mental issues going on, and we have serious mental issues going on in this country, and that needs to be addressed. We need to help these people, but,
you first have to identify who they are that are nuts, because it's hard to pick them out now.
This guy, I don't want to say his name,
down to 2 minutes.
His picture shouldn't be shown, because they create infamy. So I got to wrap it up. I'm going to leave you with the show. Have a really nice Memorial Day. Don't forget those who have served. See you next time.
A close-up look at animal welfare issues is supported by AnimalWelfareIssues.com.